Douglas Coupland has spent more than two decades chronicling modern society. He's the writer and artist and FT Weekend columnist who gave us such terms as Generation X, McJobs, and Microserfs. His latest work, Kitten Clone, is inspired by the time he spent as a writer in residence at the transatlantic telecoms company Alcatel-Lucent. And in it, he paints a disturbing view of how the internet is changing us as a species and how, as he puts it, it is rewiring our brains. Douglas, welcome to the FT.
Thanks for having
me. There's a passage in Kitten Clone where you write, and I've truncated it slightly, but you write, "My brain no longer feels the way it used to, and I miss my pre-internet brain. The internet has burrowed deep inside my head and laid eggs, and it feels like they're all hatching." Tell me about your pre-internet brain, and perhaps tell me how it feels different now.
Oh, Robert. In Vancouver, I actually made up these t-shirts that say, "I miss my pre-internet brain." And they're very popular with teenagers who have no pre-internet brain. With myself, I'm a bit nostalgic for it, but I also realize I'm starting to forget what my brain used to feel like. And it's not dementia or something. I literally have been rewired in the last 10 or 15 years. And I remember what I used to do. I used to remember doing it, but what it felt like, I don't remember. And I think I'm not alone. I think a lot of people are maybe going through that.
When you look at other people, what are the signs you see of the rewiring? What are some examples?
No longer wanting to speak on the phone, just texting, please. Mm-hmm. That's a very, very common one. I think I've been staying at a lot of hip hotels lately. And the thing about hip hotels is every single person who stays there is 31 and a half years old, has a MacBook Air laptop, an iPad and a device and buds. And everyone sits there all together in the same room, but everyone's just going in and out of portals and they're connecting with other people, but they're not connecting with other people. It's interesting and slightly creepy and slightly nice.
One thing I was very struck by, and it's certainly a thought that occurs to me as someone who was alive before the internet, you talked about a world that was fashioned by people who read books, mm-hmm. and that now we're moving into a world that isn't going to be fashioned by people who read books. Mm-hmm. And you've been careful not to predict the future. You're more like predicting the present sometimes, it feels. But how does that, what does that mean?
I think we're entering an era of far less sentimentality, a far less sentimental era. I think that people in the 20th century, which is me, mm-hmm. you, and before, we read a lot of books, and these books built into us a sort of expectation that, well, maybe your life is a narrative, maybe it has a theme and an arc, and it leads somewhere. And when you don't have that anymore, you just have the sensation of being sort of a unit among 7 billion other units. It's not a bad thing or a good thing, but your life doesn't feel like a story anymore.
Mm. You've been writing about modernity for most of your career, and it's always seemed to me that you have you'll correct me, I'm sure, if I'm wrong, that you have an ambivalence about it. You're excited, but you can also see the things that should make us uneasy. But I felt reading Kitten Clone that actually maybe you've moved from ambivalence to concern, and that there is a nostalgia in this. Would that be fair?
Well, I'm coming to grips with the whole notion of inevitability. This is one part in the book where I'm in Shanghai, it's toward the end of the book, and I'm meeting with the vice president of the Communist Party in Shanghai. And I mean, I've just finished a book about Marshall McLuhan, so I'm kind of thinking the medium is the message, and I'm very much thinking that way. And well, you know, sir, how do you feel about giving, you know, 1.3 billion people 1 gig a second of high-speed access by the year 2017 or 20? And he's like, "I know what you're talking about, but here's the thing. The future of planet Earth is high-speed broadband everywhere, always, all the time. It's unstoppable. It cannot be stopped. It's going to happen. Therefore, because it's inevitable, we just want to get there first." And I thought it's very, very smart or very, very stupid, but it's something they have thought of. And there's this sense of inevitability that we live with now. And also, the future seems to be coming at us much more quickly than it ever used to. I mean, remember in the 80s, the big change was going from rotary phones to push button. And even that was like too much to handle at first.
You compare in the book the buildings of Alcatel-Lucent, this incredibly important telecoms company, which, as you say, whose disappearance would change the world we live in dramatically. this pioneering, forward-thinking, research-based company, and you visit it in America, and it's wires and cabling everywhere. You're obviously very disappointed in the buildings. I think there's a phrase you talk about, one of their research labs is a building that's already happened. And then you go to China and you're wowed by it. And that led to, I thought, some fairly depressing conclusions, certainly for an American.
Well, in order to have a successful future as a culture, you have to do fundamental research. And what's happening is many companies, not just Alcatel-Lucent, have sort of pulled back on doing fundamental research. The thing about fundamental research is it could go nowhere. Mm-hmm. But a lot of the times it comes in handy at just the right moment. The transistor was invented because someone had done a study on almost pure silicon and its properties. And so when that's not happening, I think scientists just get bummed out. But then you go to China and it's like, it's a patent generating machine. They are there, they are creating patents, they're in intense competition with each other. And you just feel like you've been blown into the weeds. You just look at them and like, how do you compete? And it is spooky that way.
There's a phrase you use, I think, blank collar workers, which is a fairly depressing concept for anybody who's a sort of generalist. I wonder if you can expand on that a bit.
Well, in the future, that always sounds so ponderous. In the future, unless you have a genuine skill of some sort, you know, are you a good cook? Can you do an appendectomy? You're just going to be kind of faking your way through life. And you're not going to have a blue-collar labor force anymore or a middle-class white-collar labor force. We're just having people who can do genuine things or who are very, very good-looking. And just everyone else who just kind of, you know, I'll wash dishes 2 days a week, I'll do back rubs that day, and like maybe I'll do some gardening over there for all the people who have genuine skills. And the only thing that's going to make it all palatable is really good high-speed Wi-Fi access. I don't know if anyone's ever done a study. I do wonder if you gave people the choice between having internet or a job that pays 100 grand a year, but you can't have both. I think people would actually choose the internet.
So all these people who don't have pure skill job, they're going to be at home with their Oculus Rift headsets, living in a virtual reality and passing the time wearing a matrix.
Oculus, have you tried them?
I haven't tried them.
Okay.
I have seen them.
Okay, here's the thing about virtual reality. It's so much better than the real world. And I can't believe I'm saying this. It's fantastic. I tried out the most recent iteration of the goggles about 6 weeks ago, and I'd never seen them before. Holy smokes, I took them off and like, put it back on. It's way better than this.
Okay, well, after that rather bleak vision, do you feel positive about the world at all?
I'm really positive about the future. You know, there's a Chinese expression, when is the best time to plant a tree? Well, the best time is 20 years ago, and the second best time is right now. And someone yesterday asked me, would you like to have been born somewhere in the past? And I said, no. Well, the best time to be born is in the past. The next best time is right now. I'm all for the future. It's not something to be afraid of, but it is coming at us very quickly, and we need to keep our eyes open to how it is changing us.
Well, on that cheery note, I'm not sure I feel any better about the world we're moving into, but Douglas, thank you very much for coming in. And you can read more of Douglas's work on FT.com and in the FT Weekend magazine.